In the past few years, it seems like quantum is being talked about more and more. We're hearing terms like qubits, entanglement, superposition, and quantum computing. But what does any of that mean? And is quantum science really that big of a deal? Quantum science does have the potential to revolutionize our world. From changing the way we process data to predicting weather, defining the future of cybersecurity, or even discovering new medical drugs. Quantum, and specifically quantum computers, could solve countless computationally intensive problems that classical computers aren't efficient enough to solve. Across the globe, industry is betting big on it, with the quantum computing market expected to hit $943 million in 2024. The federal government is investing too, with the U.S. National Science Foundation supporting several quantum information science programs focused on research and development. Now, it's important to note that quantum computing is still in its early stages, but with potential applications in so many aspects of life, the future looks quantum.
One of the largest obstacles currently to having large-scale quantum computers is our ability to maintain these quantum superpositions and string them together with more and more qubits. We're trying to speak the language of the universe to the universe, but it's been fluent way longer than we have, and we have to learn to speak that language as fluently as it does.
Okay, so actually understanding what quantum is in a practical sense can be challenging. Traditional computers consist of billions of transistors called bits that control and amplify electrical signals. Quantum computing instead uses quantum bits, or qubits, as the fundamental building block. Unlike ordinary transistors, which can either be zero or one, qubits are governed by the laws of quantum mechanics and can be both at the same time, resulting in more efficient computing. It's an area of research that can be counterintuitive in nature, heavily mathematical, and until recently lacked visual analogies. NSF-supported researchers at three different universities agreed and have introduced a quantum education virtual reality application called Qubit VR. They're hoping that intelligent tutoring like this will provide tangible visual understanding of quantum mechanics.
We have, you know, a quantum bit, and then one of them is in zero and the other one is in zero and one. And we say, oh, if it's in one, do something to the other one. Then now it does multiple different possibilities at the same time. And the two really unique aspects of quantum mechanics that we try to use when we're building quantum computers is that of superposition, the fact that quantum bits can be in multiple states at the same time, and entanglement. The state of another quantum bit can depend on that. It doesn't work always, but if you're very clever about how to use these rules, there are some problems that you can solve exponentially faster than normal computers.
Quantum computers promise to reach speeds and efficiencies impossible for even the fastest supercomputers. But quantum computers, unlike classical ones, cannot correct errors by copying encoded data over and over. Because of this inability to self-correct, the technology hasn't seen much scale-up and commercialization. An error-corrected qubit, or logical qubit, that's the key to successfully exploiting the weirdness of quantum mechanics for computation. Since qubits themselves are inherently unstable and prone to collapse out of their quantum states, it's generally accepted that until quantum computers can run reliably on logical qubits, the technology can't really take off.
At a certain point, however, there's kind of a transition where we have enough quantum bits that we're doing things that are interesting and we're studying interesting physics and interesting, you know, kind of problems that we actually can't solve with classical computers. So we've already kind of crossed this boundary where we have just a lot of quantum bits. And now there's a bigger challenge, figuring out how to take the many quantum bits that we make and then combine them into something that we call an error-corrected qubit that actually now can do many, many more operations before having an error.
Dr. Blufstein, a NSF graduate research fellow, was part of a team of researchers working in Harvard's Lucan lab that hit a key milestone in this quest, creating a programmable logical quantum processor that's capable of encoding up to 48 logical qubits and executing hundreds of logical gate operations. Before them, the best systems demonstrated one or two logical qubits and only one quantum gate operation. The challenge of solving the long-standing problem of quantum error correction is also happening through NSF's Physics Frontier Center for Ultracold Atoms, collaboration between MIT and Harvard. The idea of quantum error correction and fault tolerance was just a theory, Now, it's moving towards reality. Still, to tackle the big problems, quantum computers will have to operate a bit better, and the engineers building them will have to be creative about how they are using them.
For a computer to be useful, at some point you have to look at, you have to measure, you have to get an output out. And in quantum mechanics, measurement is this very, very destructive operation. So if I just took an equal superposition of all the answers and measured to ask for an answer, not having done anything else, then the rules of quantum mechanics are unequivocal that all I'm going to see is a uniformly random answer. So the only hope of getting an advantage from a quantum computer is to take advantage of the way that these amplitudes, which are the basic numbers of quantum mechanics, being complex numbers, work differently from the probabilities that we're used to.
While a future powered by uniquely quantum-based technologies seems to be far on the horizon, the truth is, some of it is already here. You may even be watching this video on a device with quantum dots in it.
These semiconductor nanoparticles are called quantum dots because the electrons in the dots are trapped in three dimensions, and they can only occupy discrete energy levels. This is called quantum confinement. And by accessing discrete energy levels, quantum dots can have different optical or electrical properties for the same machine. Now, quantum dots have found a variety of applications in fields like displays, photovoltaic devices, LEDs, even quantum information science, and even biomedical technologies.
And while Dr. Abel Hassanasi has been working with perovskite crystals to make quantum dots, another group of NSF-supported physicists have been developing a new method for controlling the electron spin in silicon quantum dots. These silicon dots make ideal qubits in certain applications, thanks to their useful chemical properties, ability to scale in manufacturing, and compatibility with existing electronic technologies. A recent study found that some metals contain a high degree of quantum entanglement. These strange metals include compounds of rubidium and rhodium. In a process that took over a decade of development to achieve, NSF-supported researchers use nanoscopic crystalline films to make wires of these quantum critical materials. Quantum in the 20th century was that of theories and ideas. Now, quantum information science is defining technological developments as we move forward in the 21st. So, to answer our question from the start, yes, quantum science is that big of a deal. The research is intricate and complex, and there's still a lot to be discovered, but we're on course, boldly heading towards a quantum future.